Council member, if you'll introduce yourself and share your thoughts with us. Thank you.
Council member Jerry Carlson, town of Atherton. My topic sentence is, it's time to pull the plug. Our town was the only town in your district, Senator Smidian, that voted no on Proposition 1A. Our council is opposed to having high-speed rail use the Caltrain corridor. Nothing I've heard tonight really changes things. There are a lot of questions. I didn't hear the fact that we're going to take the four tracks out of the business plan. I understand the legal things that they have to contend with. All of these things are uncertainties, and I think that we need to have time when we see the revised business plan to make our comments. I want to comment that we are adamantly opposed to having MTC be in a broker role in terms of trying to put together the MOU for the northern section. MTC doesn't have the expertise, and MTC should butt out of the process. The Legislative Analyst's Office has estimated that it will cost another $750 million a year just to service the debt for high-speed rail. This money could be much better used for education, for repairing our transportation systems we have, and for other welfare services and other things. Caltrain doesn't need high-speed rail to survive. There are other more modern technologies, the electrification, to provide the same environmental benefits at half the capital cost, less cost for maintenance of the corridor line, and you wouldn't have the problem of brownouts as you have in Europe and elsewhere when electrification fails. In summary, the bonding capacity for our state should be reserved for projects that will be beneficial to all people, like the water project. There are plenty of opportunities to provide jobs in repairing our current infrastructure and making improvements thereof. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And let me ask our timekeeper to be a little less subtle. And again, please hold your applause. Councilmember Pat Burt, to be followed by Terry Nagel.
Thank you, Senators. Pat Burt, member of the Palo Alto City Council. I'll focus my comments around the prospective MTC High-Speed Rail Authority agreement. And this agreement, as I've heard you tonight, and you express some of your concerns on how the blended system can be assured that it will be lived up to, and that the statements and promises that are being made will actually be carried out, the MTC prospective MOU with the High-Speed Rail Authority could be a tool to help assure that those contingencies are guaranteed. And if that agreement says that the dollars will only flow to MTC under certain conditions, then that becomes an additional tool for you to use. And for us as cities, because we see this as also an area of considerable concern. The devil will be in the details in this agreement. And the city of Palo Alto will be submitting to MTC, and we will be happy to copy members of the committee with our comments and our contingencies on what would be acceptable. One of the key elements is that MTC has already communicated back to us that they do not have any intention of allowing the cities on the peninsula that this rail would go directly through to have any direct participation in this process. That their intention is to only have the two county representatives and from nine barrier area counties be deciding these crucial issues for our cities. So a representative from Brentwood would have the same authority as, or greater control than us. And I would just like to share a saying from my uncle to the senator's mentor saying, and this is regards to essentially our exclusion from that MTC process, and that is that if you're not at the table, look out, you may be on the menu.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Terry Nagel, I'm on the Burlingame Council, also on the county's transportation authority, but I'm speaking tonight as an individual who's observed these many meetings.
Thank you.
And I think that my overall observation is that our cities in San Mateo County are not comfortable with the process as it stands. We have not come together as one voice in one forum. That was supposed to be the purpose of the Peninsula Rail Program, of context-sensitive solutions, which our cities bought into, but was abandoned. And now we see ourselves being represented by the MTC. We feel that they have not been in the process, the 3+ years we have, and cannot adequately represent us at the 11th hour. We would prefer to be dealing directly with the authority and negotiating with them, just as the city of Fresno has done. That said, I don't think the majority of cities are opposed to high-speed rail if it is done right, and that's a big if. That's going to require money that is well spent on the peninsula, and at present, the MOU forecasts $2 billion maximum for the peninsula. That's a 50-mile stretch. If you take out the $1.5 billion that would be used for electrification, that's $500 million left that would be spread among the cities. Now, we don't know who's going to get the projects. We're being asked to sign an MOU without having any idea how it will impact us, when this will happen, and how much taxpayers will have to pay. So it really is a blank check that they're asking us to sign. If high-speed rail were to be done right, then it would have to be done with the full buy-in of the cities along the rail line, and we have yet to see that happen. We urge you to make that a condition of the approval. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Welcome.
Good evening. My name is Barry Chen. I'm the council member from City of Cupertino, and I'm speaking for myself, not the entire council. The high-speed rail is the way to go. There's just no doubt about it, because we cannot rely on the fossil fuel. But my suggestion in this situation here is what I heard tonight is either bookends or in the central. So if there's a way to do both, you know, spend a little bit of money on both ends of bookend and in Los Angeles area and also Bay Area, and then spend a little bit of money, also the federal money in the Central Valley, would that be possible? If that's not possible, my suggestion is probably go for the Bakersfield to the Lancaster, that corridor. Because we don't want to lose $3.5 billion. In my opinion, if we do that, that's really stupid. I mean, why we waste the money to build it? Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Good evening, honorable senators, Senator Smidian, Chair Smidian, and Senators Lowenthal, DeSaulnier, and Correa. Thank you very much for the opportunity to speak on this important subject, and for convening this hearing in Mountain View tonight. First, I would like to publicly reiterate that as of December 19th, 2011, the Palo Alto City Council has taken the position that California HSR should be terminated because the current project is far too expensive, is not what the voters approved in 2008, and its business plan is fatally flawed and not credible. However, the state chooses to move forward with the HSR project and a blended system designed for the San Francisco to San Jose segment, the City of Palo Alto requests the following actions occur. First, it is imperative that the California Attorney General's Office give its opinion on the legality of a blended system relative to Prop 1A as soon as possible, and to make that opinion public. So long as there is a cloud of uncertainty regarding the legality of a blended system hanging over the project, progressing on alternatives that might be acceptable to the peninsula is not acceptable in any meaningful way. Second, any reference to a four-track system being constructed between San Francisco and San Jose must be eliminated from all CHSRA environmental documents. This is an alignment that is uniformly opposed, and even as a mere plan, has significant negative impacts on neighborhoods bordering the Caltrain right-of-way. Finally, it needs to be understood that the City of Palo Alto's willingness to consider a blended system on the peninsula is not an endorsement of it. Discussion of a blended system is rather a starting point for dialogue on how a system could possibly be designed that our community could support, however reluctantly. Many serious and material problems, such as traffic delays caused by increased crossing gate downtimes, need to be resolved before our city can agree to any design alternative, including a blended system. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Greg Conlon, Mr. Conlon, come. Let me just check. Do we have all of our elected official speakers taken care of? Great. Then we are now into our mix. Mr. Conlon, you're first up.
I'm a future elected official. As of Friday, I'm running for the U.S. Senate, so as a Republican. But
counting against your time, Mr. Conlon.
I understand. It's going to happen. You're going to have to have four tracks going through every station. Because you can't run a train 100 miles an hour through a train station when people are standing within 20 feet. So you're going to have some kind of protection. So you're going to have to have covered trenches or tunnels at least part of the way. I mean, 8 or 10 miles. I mean, in San Francisco, they're going to build a mile tunnel for $1.5 billion, and we can't get the peninsula to get 5 or 10 miles for $3 or 4 billion. I mean, you know what happened to the 710. It never got built. I mean, you get this much opposition from this many cities, you can't build this thing politically. I mean, I've been around long enough to see what citizens can do. And if you look in Southern California, there's several projects that never got built because you didn't satisfy the local citizens. You guys are the elected guys. I'm just a wannabe. But you got to understand, if you don't get these people happy, you're not going to build it. They will figure out a way. I mean, the people will speak at some point, either by putting you out of office or just suing you till you can't handle it any longer. So I just think that you got to keep them happy. Put it in a trench, put it in a tunnel, spend the money. It can't be more than $2 or 3 billion on a $100 billion project. That's less than 2 or 3% to get this thing done and get the support of the people who are most affected by it.
Thank you for your comments. He followed by Jillian Gillette. Do we have any of those folks present?
Yes.
Thank you.
Bingo. Right behind Mr. Richard.
Welcome, and thanks for staying with us.
Hi, I'm Martha Whetstone from San Francisco International Airport, and I would like to read a letter from our director, John Martin. On behalf of the San Francisco International Airport, I'm writing in strong support of high-speed rail and the initial operating project that delivers high-speed train service to the Transbay Terminal, which will be the region's intermodal transit operating hub that also includes the Millbrae Station that connects to San Francisco International Airport via BART. Passenger traffic at SFO is expected to grow to 50 million passengers by 2025. Currently, the LA Basin is the destination for 15% of flights from SFO and 36% of flights from Oakland and San Jose. High-speed rail will reduce the need for short-haul commuter flights and provide greater ability for SFO to accommodate international and long-haul domestic flights. It is important that the San Francisco Peninsula have a coordinated transportation system that incorporates improvements for Caltrans, commuter rail, high-speed rail, BART, bus transit, and air travel. I look forward to developments along the corridor, and I will assist as necessary to achieve the will of the voters in passing Proposition 1A, signed John L. Martin, Airport Director.
Thank you very much for your testimony. Next witness.
Senator Jim Lazarus, San Francisco Chamber of Commerce. I also chair the Citizens Advisory Commission for the Transbay Transit Center. Thank you for taking the time and bringing this hearing to the peninsula this evening. The San Francisco Chamber has been a longstanding supporter of high-speed rail, and we really, in listening through the hearing this evening, see that progress has been made. I think when that revised business plan comes out, it will answer many of the questions that were posed by the senators here this evening. And I think we're on the cusp of a solution. A solution in Southern California to that bookend and a solution to the Northern California bookend along the peninsula into San Francisco. People are working today in San Francisco on high-speed rail. We are building a $1.5 billion transit center, which would have had no basement and would have cost $100 million more to build 10 years from now if we didn't have $400 million of federal high-speed rail money to fast-track the building in the proper sequence and dig the hole and build that rail station under that transit station today. 5 years from now, that building will be open, waiting for an electrified Caltrain. And after an electrified Caltrain, will come high-speed rail. We urge you to go forward with support for the federal preferred alternatives in the Central Valley, the funding in Southern California and the Northern Bookend, and then, in fact, this connection from Bakersfield to Palmdale would be the third phase. We salute your efforts on this. We know you've spent countless hours throughout California and up in Sacramento on these hearings, and you've heard from a lot of people. And I think ultimately, though, the people spoke in 2008 along this peninsula from 80% support in San Francisco to 70 to 60% in the Southern Peninsula area. So we urge you to move forward with this project as expeditiously as possible within your fiduciary duties.
Thank you for your comments. Jillian Gillette to be followed by Sally Lieber, Mike Brady, and Don Barnby.
Senator Simidian, Desaulnier, Lowenthal, and Correa, thank you for calling this hearing and for inviting the region to make public comment. I am Jillian Gillette, Transportation Policy Director for the Office of Mayor Edwin M. Lee in San Francisco. San Francisco supports high-speed rail. We are currently building the very first California high-speed rail project, the Transbay Transit Center, as Jim Lazarus mentioned, a state-of-the-art mixed-use train station that embodies the kind of smart growth that cities are all about. We do not have the capacity at our airport or on our roads or freeways to support the population and job growth that we know is coming. As we know from last year's National Airport Management Study by the Government Accountability Office, SFO is one of the airports that contributes to flight delays around the country. For California and for the Bay Area to remain the global economic engines that we are, we need to invest in a sustainable transportation network that will support our jobs and innovation, bring travel and tourism, raise property values, and cut pollution and dependence on foreign oil. High-speed rail is that investment. San Francisco is a partner in a negotiation brokered by the Metropolitan Transportation Commission to present the High-Speed Rail Authority with a regional memorandum of understanding by the end of this month to upgrade existing rail service and prepare for a future high-speed rail train project that is limited to the infrastructure necessary to support a blended system shared by both Caltrain and high-speed rail. San Francisco is committed to working with our regional, state, and federal partners to identify cost-effective opportunities for additional capacity, economic development, and sustainability priority. We will continue to make our commitment to high-speed rail, and we urge you to do the same. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments. Sally Lieber to be followed by Mike Brady, to be followed by Don Barnby. I think Ms. Lieber had to pass. Mike Brady, to be followed by Don Barnby.
Good evening.
Welcome.
Mike Brady, I'm the attorney who sued High Speed Rail to stop the use of Proposition 1A bond funds in the Central Valley on grounds that it would be illegal to provide them. From what I've heard tonight, the blended system has exactly the same problems, and so at an appropriate time, a lawsuit will be filed to stop the use of Proposition 1A for the blended system. Now, an issue that you have not talked about tonight is this. Why do you have to use Proposition 1A for what you want to do? Your blended system, which has now been revealed, says this. LA passengers are dropped off in San Jose. They then get on a Caltrain train and go to San Francisco.
Mr. Brady, let me just stop you for a moment, please. And I apologize, but I want to be very clear. That's not the proposal that was advanced by Congresswoman Eshoo, Assemblymember Rich Gordon, or myself. It is what is referred to as a one-seat ride, and I just want to clarify that for the record. Please proceed.
Yes, and there's been much talk about that system, whether you get off, get on a Caltrain train, and go to San Francisco. There is no reason why the passenger from San Jose cannot ride on an improved diesel Caltrain. Caltrain has enough money in the bank right now to have an improved diesel system. You don't have to use Proposition 1A. What is the appeal to the peninsula from using improved diesel? High-speed rail never enters the corridor because high-speed rail can't use diesel. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments. Next witness is Don Barnby, to be followed by Karen Perry, David Schwagel, and Betsy McGinn.
Don Barnby, Menlo Park. The topic is facts versus beliefs. A study at the University of Michigan shows that when confronted with facts that they believe to be true, People will nevertheless reject those facts if they offend or undermine their belief systems. The benefits originally promised by HSR were a glorious dream, a belief, not a fact. Good, independent, unbiased studies have shown that the HSR dream is fallacious and unattainable. Nevertheless, legislatures are still trying to redefine the parameters and gerrymander the facts and the law to shoehorn them into the fantasy and belief and dream. The facts of HSR are now well known. You legislatures know them.
Yes.
And also you know that the voters are now overwhelmingly opposed to HSR. Two-thirds of California voters have demonstrated sufficient personal integrity to say that the facts matter, and they now don't want HSR. And they did that even though they were originally in favor of it. Think about this, a swing from 53% favoring HSR several years ago down to 33% now means 20%, one-fifth of Californians have shown the character and integrity to change their minds when shown the facts, and to do that in spite of their initial dream. Given the University of Michigan study about human nature, that is very remarkable.
Thank you for your comments. Karen Perry to be followed by David Schwagel, to be followed by Betsy McGinn. And my apologies if I'm doing the pronunciations a disservice here. Welcome.
Hello. I'm Karen Perry. I've lived on California Drive in Burlingame for 16 years along the rail corridor. My husband and I have raised 4 children in a 2-bedroom, 1-bath home. Before BART arrived in Millbrae, our street hit a dead end on Millbrae Avenue. When BART came, Millbrae Avenue vaulted over and California Drive became a thoroughfare, effectively turning it into a freeway. I don't park in my driveway because I can't enter into traffic. 4 of our cars have been hit and 1 totaled, along with a picket fence and a retaining wall, as a result of the increased traffic. Adding another mode of transit to the Millbrae station will stall us entirely, along with the one and only police station, also located on California Drive in Burlingame. This is the only home we have owned. We want to live our lives, our years, out in our modest home in peace, not dealing with the noise and trembling of constant high-speed trains. Please consider the homeowners and renters along the corridor, which are the smallest and least expensive dwellings in our city, and kill this project. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments. David Schwagel to be followed by Betsy McGinn, to be followed by Michael G. Bell.
Good evening. David Schwagel from Californians for High Speed Rail. I traveled over 150 miles here to tell you that we must move forward with the largest, most profitable rail line in the nation and a top 5 in the world. The $98.5 billion price tag is minuscule when you consider the fact that America spends $156 billion per year in congestion. Plus, we lose 43,000 lives every year on our highways. Meanwhile, the Japanese bullet train, the Shinkansen, has carried over 10 billion passengers over 5 decades without a passenger fatality. And as we know from the Great Depression, when the tough gets going here in the Silicon Valley residents go high tech. Well, this high-speed rail project brings a plethora of new technologies here to the Silicon Valley. Now, I mentioned on Facebook, and I will mention it here, nothing is more important to America's future than pushing this project forward. Nothing. Umpqua Bank CEO Ray Davis says, "The world watches the U.S. The U.S. watches California. Build it." Thank you.
Thank you for your comments. Folks, again, could we have Betsy McGinn, followed by Michael Bell, followed by William Cutler, followed by Kristen Mercer, followed by Rob Hagee. Welcome.
Hello. Thank you. Betsy McGinn from Burlingame, California.
Ms. McGinn, I think we need to adjust that microphone just slightly. We've got someone there just a little bit. Thank you.
Thank you. I am here today to present to you a letter that was written by our Burlingame City Council to Governor Brown on March 1st. Since I don't have the time to read the entire thing, I'll just read you the first and last paragraphs to give you the gist. Dear Governor Brown, we write to request that your administration place the 2008 Proposition 1A back on the ballot in November so that Californians, not legislators and not consultants, can make a decision about whether they want to invest in high-speed rail at this time based on the substantial new information available, much of what we've talked about tonight. In conclusion, they say, but if you don't trust our judgment and you're not willing to revisit your own, then at least trust the voters, ask them what they think about it all. And that is from our mayor and council. And while I'm up here, I just wanted to make a quick comment about Mr. Richard's glowing report earlier about the BART extension to SFO and the funding that came from heaven. What he didn't tell you is the original funding for that project was $590 million. It ballooned to $1.5 billion. The ridership was projected at 70,000 per day. It's less than half of that 13 years later. And so I just want to remind us all of the definition of insanity, which is doing the same thing over and over again and expecting a different outcome. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm William Cutler from Palo Alto. Topic sentence. For the blended approach, the only way to do grade separations in residential neighborhoods is streets on the surface, train below grade. There are four ways to do grade separations. Two of them involve massive overhead structures, either the tracks raised or the street vaulting over. And both of those, as we have already determined many times, are totally unacceptable in residential neighborhoods because they are in absolute egregious violation of all planning and zoning, which has been in effect for years and years. The remaining possibilities are either keep the streets on the surface and put the train below grade, or keep the train on the surface and put the streets below grade. And I'll compare these on the basis of community impact, safety, and cost. Obviously, the community impact of putting the train below grade is much superior in that it gets the train out of sight and out of sound and opens up the possibility of improving the intersections of the cross streets with the street that runs parallel to the tracks. In this case, in Palo Alto, that would be Alma Street. With regard to safety, consider the situation of an underpass on cross streets with many school children walking and riding bicycles, going down a steep grade, encountering a busy cross street at the bottom of the grade, and then trudging up the other side, all in very confined areas. That is a safety nightmare for our children and should never be considered. With regard to cost, putting the train underground in it requires about a mile and a half of excavation for the Charleston and Meadow crossings. There is about a mile of street excavation if the streets go underground, and on top of that, there is the cost of the takings of a dozen or so homes. So it's quite clear that the costs, if anything, are equal or superior to put the train underground. So I want you to appreciate that. It's in light with your admonition to get all of the details decided beforehand before committing the money.
Thank you very much for your testimony. Is Kristen Mercer with us? How about Rob Hagee or Michael Bell? Welcome.
Good evening. I'm Rob Hagee, San Bruno, native of San Francisco. I actually rode the electric train across the Bay Bridge three times when I was a child. I love trains. I'll start off with that. But I don't like you're sitting on a dog and pony show now. I mean, we were told in 2008 that you're going to build high-speed rail for X amount of dollars, and now it's going to cost $250 million per mile, basically. I don't know. And I'm trying to figure out, everybody's going to be upset. I'm still trying to, and they're finally doing it in San Bruno, where 20 years ago you were supposed to San Bruno Avenue and the railroad were supposed to be separated. Thank you for finally getting to it, And then what happens when the first train runs over somebody and stops the train somewhere, wherever, and the highway patrol or who's ever doing the investigation for 6 hours to get the body off the tracks, and nobody can go anywhere. And then all these high-speed rail tracks that you put in, where are you putting all the freight trains? I mean, Now 101's going to, you can, you know, for every 100-car freight train, you got to put 2,000 trucks out there? Oh, excuse me. I hear the trains at night going up and down, you know, because I live close enough to the trains, and I hear them. What are you going to do? I mean, I'm trying to figure out. Nobody's thought all the things out, you know, because if I'm on a train and I want to get to L.A., which I really don't want to go to downtown L.A. anyway, but... See, Northern California people know downtown Los Angeles. Anyway, you drive it. I mean, I'm stuck out in the middle of Atwater, California, and it's 110 degrees. And not only did they run over somebody, the power failed, and the air conditioner is not working now. On the God, I might as well be on the tarmac at San Francisco Airport going, because at least I know they'll eventually launch the plane. So, folks, come on.
Let me say thank you for your comments. Appreciate you being here tonight.
Don't travel.
Welcome. And you may want, there you go. Oh, it's still perfect.
$8 billion to create 134 miles of railway in the middle of nowhere. And this isn't even a fully functional high-speed rail system. Now that's a good plan. A stranded investment. We heard testimony here that it was going to be standalone. One utility, well, it certainly is, out in the middle of nowhere. It's no investment at all. It's a foolish waste of time and money. With less than 3% of the population currently using mass transit, it makes no sense to have 97% of the population paying to subsidize a train to nowhere. We're already spending over $100 million a year on Amtrak subsidies. The voters voted Proposition 1A for specific funding. And now it's 10 times more, and the voters should get another chance at voting for this proposition or not and how the funds should be used. So it seems to me that the panel is more concerned about getting federal funding than they are about doing what's right for California. And from what I hear, we don't want high-speed rail.
Thank you. It's Ms. Gass, yes?
Goss,
forgive me. Thank you for your comments. Neil Shea to be followed by Marcy Abramovitz, to be followed by Stephen Hazel. Any of those three folks still with us?
God's words from my mouth to your ears. In the beginning.
And could you tell us who you are, please, just for the record?
I'm God. My mortal name's Stephen Hazel. That's Stephen with a PH. Steve.
One moment. I just wanted to let you know that even though you were God, 2 minutes, please, okay? So go right ahead.
Let me take my jacket off. In the beginning, the voters cast a vote which included a cost. That cost actually more than tripled because your worst case scenario says $118 billion, okay? That's more than the net worth of the three richest men on my planet Earth here, green Earth. It exceeds that number, okay? The economy, we're on life support right now. At best, we're still in intensive care. All right? Now, this is just unbelievable. Because the fact is, you represent everybody here. This is just a snapshot to all the millions of people in the state of California. The cost has changed. HSR, that's high-speed sanity rail. Okay? That's fraud. That's deception. We deserve to have a revote because you know the majority of the people, we have a opportunity to opt out, to cancel the contract. It's like I go in and buy a car for $30,000. The shovels aren't even in the ground yet. I pick up the car, it's 100 grand. I tell the salesman, he goes, well, I've got some creative financing for you. No, I want to cancel the contract, okay? And that's your duty, okay? To put it on the ballot, let the voters vote again, and you know, and I know, and everybody knows, that's it. I'm going to save you a lot of money here, okay? And it's not even going to cost you a dime, all right? I'm not charging you a dime for this, what I'm telling you right now. And that's the way it is, because high-speed rail is a joke, okay? It is. It's a joke. And everybody knows it, and the only reason why these guys want to push it is because they got big, fat egos, okay? They want to attach their name to this project. Okay, that's going to make them a big man.
And time.
Okay.
Thank you very much. And if you just introduce yourself.
Martin Sommer, Palo Alto.
Thanks, Mr. Sommer. Yeah.
My topic sentence is invest all the available money now in the north-south bookends and accelerate the projects to a five-year timeline. The 3 points on that is 3 years ago, we were at Cubberley Center in Palo Alto, and I stood up and fortunately you guys backed up the idea, but I stood up and said, hey, look, $4 billion to go from San Jose to San Francisco with a four-track system, you can do it for $1 billion and by upgrading Caltrain. Here we are 3 years later. We finally have public support, the majority, I would say, on an electrified Caltrain. My take is do it now. And don't push off the deadline. Keep to a five-year time frame. The second point is the Central Valley reasoning that they need a test track does not hold water. We are buying tested technology and engineering standards. We're not building high-speed trains from scratch, and we're not doing it for the first time. So there's no justification for a test track in the middle of nowhere. The third point is the senator, I see he's not sitting there, but he brought up the point of the risk of the federal funding by focusing on the bookends instead of the Central Valley up front. My advice is take the risk. It's our system and it's our state. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Next witness, and if you'd identify yourself, please.
Hello, my name is Daniel Krause, Executive Director for California's High Speed Rail. Thank you for having this very informative hearing. I wanted to just convey our position on the blended system. Originally, we were quite skeptical of the blended system, but due to the leadership of Mr. Smidian and your other colleagues, we actually do strongly support the blended system. Now we think it's a very wise way to approach both saving costs and also involving more people in the project, so there's more support. So just wanted to convey that support. And we also look forward to, we understand there's a lot of concern about risk of the project, and that's understandable for your position to look at risk. That's your responsibility. So in the coming days, I look forward to talking to you and other legislators about why our organization thinks that the high-speed rail project is the low-risk alternative compared to not doing high-speed rail. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments.
I'm Karen Chappelle. I live in Palo Alto.
Thank you.
I think it's time to pull the plug on this. The cost has multiplied by more than three. The time to build it has increased by probably about three times. Most of us, judging from the poll numbers I've seen, don't want it anymore. And all of the talk of this empty space in the Central Valley they're going to put their test track on, that's people's farms, family farms. And the track has been set to go right through the middle of almost all of them. It would make much better sense to run the thing from Sacramento to north end of Los Angeles, hook it up to Metrolink on one end, run it down I-5 in the middle, hook it up to San Jose via the ACE train, and hook it up to San Francisco via an extended BART. I know it means you have to get off the train sometimes, but really, it makes a lot more sense. If you do go for the blended system, we need an ironclad guarantee that they will not be building aerial, they will not expect the cities to divert the roads, and that they will not, having snuck their camel's nose under the tent, they won't try to put four tracks in there. I don't trust them. I've watched them, and the new lot seemed to be a little more amenable. The last lot was an absolute disaster. We still need to stop it or re-vote. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your comments.
Thank you, Russ Cohen, City of Burlingame. I don't know if it adds any credibility to what I have to say, but I am a former city council member in the city of Burlingame. It might actually ruin my credibility, I'm not sure. I want to thank you for your diligence on this particular topic, but despite your diligence, I am still a very angry and confused Democrat. And that's because the discussion has become a partisan one. It has become the Republicans are against high-speed rail, and the Democrats are for high-speed rail. This is despite numerous independent studies raising concerns and thousands of public comments raising even more concerns. And I want to know, how many more studies do you need to read? How many more constituents do you need to hear from? How many more polls do you need to review before you and your Democratic colleagues begin to advocate and tell Governor Brown that high-speed rail's real, very real risk is much greater than its wholly imagined benefits? We've got to start now. I might just add that there was a really great cartoon in today's Daily Post featuring both Senator Simidian and Lowenthal, and I'd be more than happy to furnish you with signed copies for your office.
Appreciate the offer, and thank you for your comments.
I knew that was me.
Yeah.
Next witness. Thank you.
Hi, Nadia Nayak from CARD. After 3 years, we seem to have gone nowhere with regard to this process. Cities that are years away from high-speed rail are being asked to turn a blind eye to the major deficiencies with the project on the hope that they might someday receive money for their area. Nothing seems to have changed. Political promises are being made towards predetermined outcomes. We've all seen this movie before. One by one, cities, counties, school districts, agencies, and councils of governments in the Central Valley are delving into the details of this plan and making it clear that these plans don't work for the communities and they don't approve. The authority should be addressing community concerns directly with detailed plans that would explain mitigations to impacts and provide a financial plan showing how they would pay for them. Instead, the authority is seeking political support from areas of the state where high-speed rail won't exist for years, or from agencies like MTC that do not represent the cities where the project will actually be. Another troubling issue is that the EIR doesn't actually match the business plans or the plans being articulated publicly. A plan is a plan. The environmental work should support the plan. The way they're going about this is disingenuous and not the way to rally the much-needed public support for the project. CARD has maintained from the beginning that the way to be successful on this project is to work early, openly, honestly, often, and directly with community stakeholders throughout the process to jointly figure out how to build this project. Clearly, that's not what's going on. We are within months of beginning construction on a project where we're still trying to sell a viable business plan. Senators, we ask you to continue to ask the hard questions. They have lost their way, and it's up to you to uphold the law and remind the authority that CEQA and AB 3034 have specific requirements to protect the people from exactly the kind of shenanigans going on right now. Please stay vigilant. And I ask you, if you're asked for CEQA exemption on any piece of this project, we hope that you will say a strong no. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments. Next witness.
Lawrence Carl from Mountain View.
Welcome.
My concern is that the shared track approach is not cost effective. Part of the problems are that, first, it increases train weight, and it limits the speed, which makes the high-speed rail less cost and time effective. Second, it increases contention on the regional routes already, which makes those regional trains less cost-effective and less time-effective. Instead, I think that the high-speed rail should concentrate on connecting the ends of the regional routes rather than trying to push its way into the center and work from that standpoint. And to make that the overall system effective, you need to increase the effectiveness of the regional routes, moving the train speeds up to higher speeds in the regional routes, which benefits everybody, not just the people with a high-speed rail ticket. And thank you for your time.
Thank you for your comments. Next witness.
Good evening, Senators. Thank you for the hearing tonight, and thanks for sticking with us this late at night as well.
Thank you for sticking with us.
My name is Rita Westby. I'm a co-founder of CARD, which is Californians Advocating Responsible Rail Design, and I have come with a topic sentence. There ought to be a law, but why bother? CARD's focus has been on transparency, accountability, and oversight. And it's been said that AB 3034 has more oversights than any other bill. Those oversights were put in place to protect the public from the various things that can go wrong with such a large project. The oversights were also used to assure the public that the law can protect us from bad outcomes. AB 3034 says that the peer review group will report on the soundness of the authority's plans, engineering, which we've not seen just yet, their opinion of, and financing. Their opinions are for the purpose of informing the public, among others. Unfortunately, the authority asked the peer review group to hold off publicizing their comments on the business plan and got approval from the legislature to do so. And this is not a good example of transparency. This is a public works project, and transparency must be with the public. However, we seem to have gone back to the decide, announce, defend model that we agreed nearly two years ago is not a desirable model. So we've heard of high-speed rail done right, and we'd also like to strive for oversight done right. For the state to have a good outcome and protect us from harm, AB 3034 and all of its protections must be followed. We cannot selectively ignore any of them, no matter how inconvenient some of them may be, and we're dependent on you for effective oversight. There ought to be a law, and there is. I have another topic sentence, and that is to fund or not to fund. And that's the question you'll be facing, and you know, you'll probably have a few questions that you might consider. Is their funding plan legal? Is their business plan solid? Is the ridership believable? Do the EIRs reflect their plan? Do they address community concerns? Do they have the staff required to execute their plans? Is their information like job numbers or cost of doing nothing believable? Is funding likely? If funding is uncertain, is Plan B a good, well thought out investment? What will be cut from the state budget to fund this project? You can prioritize these any way you like, because I'm not sure you can check off even one of them. The fear of losing $3 billion of federal money is wagging $98 billion dog. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments. Mi Trong, to be followed by George Yang.
Good evening. My name is Mi Trong from Sunnyvale. I checked the U.S. debt today. It was over $15 trillion. Where's the money? What's our priority here? Is a high-speed rail? The state of California and federal government have been in budget crisis for many years. It keep on kicking the can down the road. When is the end? The Fed is cutting Social Security for the senior, Medicare, doctor reimbursement, veteran care, education, and many more. The state is also cutting the public service and underfunding pension. The assumption of ridership is laughable. My question is, where we got all those money? Another concern I have is the safety and the cost. The safety, yesterday I read the AP article. It says, the rail collapsed in central China. In a year, there's a two accidents for the high-speed rail. That's my concern also. Another concern I have is the cost may triple over many years. I believe high-speed rail plan is not financially feasible. There's no guarantee the Fed will have the money to continue funding this project. On top of that, state of California has to match billions of dollars that stay, and some cities are in the brink of bankruptcy. I don't see any benefit to keep this project going. We don't have climate change crisis, but we do have overspending crisis.
And your final sentence, please.
I urge you to discontinue the project and put the Measure 1A back to the ballot. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Mr. Yang, welcome.
Hello, I'm George. I'm from Menlo Park. I'm a software engineer, and I can't help but notice that Mr. Campton earlier and Mr. Senator Lowenthal here does not need to be here, actually, because with new technology, we can have virtual meetings where if we set up a teleconference here, they can be here without actually having to fly all the way here. Earlier, Mr. Witcher has mentioned that predict that there will be a lot of business travel between San Francisco and LA, they will keep pace with population growth. As an engineer, I don't see that happening because many of the virtual meeting technologies will make it easier for business to meet without actually having to fly. So I question the need to expand airport capacity as well as the ridership projections that are based on an increase in business travel. I don't see that happening. There will be some increase, but not as much as necessary to sustain such a project at this magnitude. In closing, I want to mention that based on former Vice President Al Gore, if we don't reduce carbon emission by 2020, our Earth is going to be in deep trouble. Now, this project is not going to finish until 2034, which means that whatever we are doing in construction is only going to add more strain to Earth. So my question to everybody is that, is this project, if you believe in President Al Gore, Vice President Al Gore, would that help us? Would it help us or would it hurt us in terms of global warming? Thank you.
Thank you for your comments. Welcome.
Good evening, Senators Correa, Simidian, Lowenthal, Desaunier. Thank you for asking the tough questions, but also for your commitment to make this happen. We know you're trying hard to figure out how to solve this conundrum. My name is Neil Struthers. I'm the Vice President of the California State Building Trades. This is an organization that represents approximately 300,000 construction workers and their families. And it's probably no news, it's not new news to you that our industry has suffered disproportionately to any other industry during this long recession. We've had as much as 30% unemployment for our members for not just months, but years now. So it should come as no surprise that the building trades are here tonight and that we support high-speed rail because we know it puts people to work. We know it creates jobs. We know it will create tens of thousands of jobs. But this project is more than just putting people back to work. This is about the future of California. California is a place where people come to think big. Had previous leaders not shown long-term big-picture thinking, we would not have the Golden Gate Bridge, we would not have the Bay Bridge, and we would not have BART. Thankfully, few people listened to Berkeley Mayor Wallace Johnson in 1966 when he called BART a billion-dollar fiasco. Of course, now, you can't imagine life in the Bay Area without the Golden Gate Bridge, without the Bay Bridge, and without BART. We know, and you know as well, that leadership requires being able to prepare for tomorrow and able to see the needs of the state clearly and act appropriately and plan accordingly. We are confident that all of you will find a solution to this conundrum and will make high-speed rail authority, and we urge you to continue the leadership of previous leaders in this great state and to think big and to get this project done. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your comments.
Thank you. I'd like to start by thanking Mr. Hartnett and Mr. Richard for their support of the blended system. And I'd like to touch on Southern California, the Central Valley, the Peninsula, and close with a present to Mr. Richard. The only possibility for an FRA test track is a line between LA and Las Vegas, period. In the Central Valley, funding needs to be put on hold until the authority hires engineers capable of designing a 220-mile-an-hour line. Until then, the only possible investments are electrification, positive train control, and closing the gap between Bakersfield and Palmdale. Currently, the Peninsula segment is the only one that can be fully compliant with Prop 1A. But Caltrain must be held to the same standards as high-speed rail, and that includes attracting a private operator capable of providing a faster service without an operating subsidy. In closing, the only way we will ever be able to afford high-speed rail in California is to bring costs down to European levels. And that includes connecting Caltrain to Transbay for less than $500 million. So I'd like to present Mr. Richard with a copy of the manual used by the British government to inform their decisions on high-speed line expenditure. Now, anybody else can download the download this document from the engineering section of the HS2 website, which is hs2.org.uk/engineer-docs. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments. And if you will, identify yourselves just so we can keep track of who's who and what's what.
Tony Lima. Oops. Tony Lima from
Welcome, Mr. Lima.
From Los Altos.
Thank you.
I only have one quick comment. Mr. Richard said late in his testimony that, let me make sure that I get this correct, I'm sorry, that he wasn't asking for $98.5 billion. He was only asking for $2.7 billion, and then he made the comment that each phase should stand on its own. I seem to recall that earlier the statement was made that the first leg would not be economically viable on its own. I just wanted to point out that little contradiction. And Mr. Richards.
Thank you for your comments. Next witness.
My name is Robert Moffat. I'm a practicing engineer, been teaching mechanical engineering at Stanford for the last 40 years. And I'm interested in high-speed rail. I strongly favor it. I've traveled in Japan, traveled in France, and high-speed rail is absolutely, I think, necessary for California. It fits us beautifully. We're long and skinny. We have a distributed wealth, big at one end, big at the other end, and we have productive farmland in the middle. We need to do a couple of things with high-speed rail that I don't think even the French have done yet. We need to put cargo cars on that can be loaded the way aircraft are loaded, with pods that are preloaded so they slip in. You could load the whole railroad car in roughly a minute and a half with these things. Now you can take your high-value produce to market quickly from the Central Valley. I don't know how you're going to get it down there and get it in, but there are ways of expanding the revenue stream from these high-speed trains. Now, we've heard a lot of talk about cost. In fact, it brought out some really good sound bites. I don't have any sound bites for you, but I would like to point out that at $100 billion spread over 20 years, that's $5 billion a year, but that produces revenue which will offset the cost. We're spending $7.5 billion a year housing our prison industry. And frankly, I would much rather spend money on rail than on the prison industry. In terms of routes, I would say the thing that I would recommend you keep in mind on the routes is that nobody likes change. I'm reminded of Daniel Boone moving out of Kentucky because it got too damn crowded for him. He could see the smoke from his neighbor's chimney, and that meant it was too crowded for him.
Well, he needed a spare the air day, Mr. Moffat. That would have solved the problem.
That would have solved his problem. But, you know, we're building not something just for the first year or two of shock value of having a new train in the peninsula. We're talking about a 20, 30, 50-year investment. People coming in here 10 years from now, if they see the train in place, that's the way the world is. They will adapt immediately.
Thank you.
And
thank you for your comments.
Keep that one in mind. Am I out?
You are. I'm sorry, sir. Thank you very much. Next witness.
I'm Conrad Sosnow, and I live here in beautiful Mountain View. And my bottom line is I want to revote. So I voted for 1A, but since then, the cost has gone up by a factor of 3. Time has been extended dramatically. The projections for passengers is down. The ticket cost is up. So I'm trying to wonder, was this either because of gross incompetence or was it deliberate fraud on the voters? So I want a revote to be able to go up or down. Now, what I heard tonight is a rational person would take the California money and build the Bakersfield to Palmdale line. That's the rational person, but not the political person. So let me give you 2 predictions. One, political pressure from Washington will force the 130 miles built in Central Valley. Washington will call Jerry Brown. Jerry Brown's office will call all of you. They'll squeeze, and it's going to happen. That's my first prediction. The second prediction is someday your grandchildren will visit the California Railroad Museum in Sacramento, and on display, they'll see this platinum spike. And what it'll say is this is the spike from the 130-mile Obama Railroad in Central California. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments. Next witness is, welcome.
Pam Farley.
Welcome.
As far as spending goes, the problem that we have is that California already has so much debt that we can't look forward to 20 years of spending something that's integral maybe to our state. I have a problem with ridership subsidies. That means more taxes to me. I also have a problem with cap and trade revenues, which I'm not quite sure how you're going to get revenues from cap and trade other than it means more taxes on someone. I think I would like to see the legislator focus more on the coming unfunded pension tsunami that's going to hit California in the next 30 years. So I would say no on high-speed rail at this point. We don't have the money.
Thank you for your comments.
Well, good evening. My name is Bob Saldick. I'm delivering a message from my wife, Virginia Saldick. She would love to be here, but she was accidentally knocked down while leaving a Peninsula Cities Consortium meeting in Brisbane on high-speed rail. She broke her hip, but I hope she's somehow listening to this program. Ginny's message: how dare them to gut the crown jewel of California, its higher education system, especially the University of California, with such a specious and unneeded project as high-speed rail. They're going to bankrupt the state and put it into overwhelming debt and debt service to garner funds that nowhere near balance the cost of acquiring those funds. The project will eviscerate intact neighborhoods as well and put a heavy industrial project in dense residential neighborhoods. She's talking about Palo Alto. In just the 6-block by 8-block neighborhood in the east of the tracks in Old Palo Alto, there are 267 homes either newly built or so substantially remodeled that their year built done is effectively the remodel date. I can testify to the accuracy driving her around all the old houses in Palo Alto. Don't let creeping blight reverse this trend. On the west side of the tracks in the Southgate neighborhood, the environmental impact reaches half the neighborhood. Irresponsible governance in its extreme. Her advice: feed Jerry Brown's ego some other way that doesn't damage the quality of life. Give these good people the benefit of the whole and don't burden their children as well with crippling state debt. Preserve the low-cost public education system of the state and the traditional path of upward mobility in this state. Let them be Jerry Brown's legislative legacy.
Thank you, Mr. Saldick. Next witness is
Jim Bigelow. Welcome, Mr. Redwood City, San Mateo County Chamber. No stranger to this subject. The most recent and most focused points of your discussion have been the early opportunity for early investment in the bookends. And that is quite appealing down south as well as on the peninsula. Caltrain and high-speed rail are 100% compatible. Caltrain worked for 3 years to get a new national standard for lighter weight electric trains, which helps speed up the high-speed rail implementation. And our chamber board is going to be addressing this further on the early opportunity and the MTC MOU next week at their board meeting. So I think this is promising, positive news. And I can tell you, as I have probably in the past, as a pilot, I've flown a multi-engine airplane behind a heavy jet, and you get wake turbulence. And the FAA had to change the in-trail standard from 3 nautical miles when you're in the overcast coming in on an approach because of the buffeting of a heavy aircraft like a 747, a 777, and so forth. So that's reduced the capacity of the airports. Then when you take and you have an extended lower ceiling, you have to cancel flights, you have to delay flights all over the U.S. The Fly California that's on the side of this train totally makes sense to me as a pilot. So next time you look at the picture that says Fly California, there's a reason. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments. Next witness. Welcome.
Yeah.
My name's Brian Reisdorp, and I'm actually a resident of Santa Clara, not in your district, but I came here because I'm concerned on this issue. I support high-speed rail, and high-speed rail is proven to be the most environmentally sensitive form of long-distance transportation. I support the Rail Authority's plan to build in the Central Valley and the blended approach on the peninsula and in Southern California. And high-speed rail is more than just an efficient and sustainable form of transportation. It supports better development patterns as we design and build our cities. It will actually should improve the livability on the peninsula. And I suspect a lot of the opponents of this project base their opposition just on the changes needed to the Caltrain right-of-way. They ignore the fact that many of those changes are needed regardless, even if there's no high-speed rail. If you want a system that is comparable to BART in efficiency in serving the people, we need grade separation on Caltrain. We need electrification. And the media hasn't been helping to spread informed information. Papers like the Palo Daily are pretty biased in the reporting. They're more like editorial pieces. And Palo Alto is actually my hometown. It's where I grew up. But I'm actually ashamed of a lot of the self-serving opposition to the high-speed rail project. You know, global warming is a serious problem. But in Palo Alto, they're more concerned about losing one lane of traffic on Alma. You know, it's what Al Gore says. They're not willing to face any inconvenient truths. And it's a city, in a way, not just Palo Alto, but up the peninsula. Many of these cities, they just epitomize the kind of the hypocrisy. And I think the hypocrisy, you accuse authority of, say, building in the Central Valley as their first initial segment. Then cities like Palo Alto talk about building a tunnel, a four-track tunnel to, you know, it's not as simple as building a tunnel for BART. It's a major impact and major expense. And so there are reasons why building the Central Valley to get the most mileage for the limited funds they got from the government. So that's it.
Thank you for your comments.
Good evening, Senators. Thank you very much for hosting this event. My name is Aaron Fukuda, and I've traveled here from the Central Valley representing Citizens for California High-Speed Rail Accountability. My take-home point: the Valley doesn't want this project. We ask our legislators, please stop the mismanagement of this project and vanquish that black cloud you were talking about over all of our residents. We call that black cloud high-speed rail. I was going to give you a talk today, but I noticed there were some talking points up here, and it harkens back to the December 5th hearing at which I was at. It seems like the authority wants to pressure the legislators into making a decision quickly and inefficiently, like they've produced their reports. At that meeting, they indicated that we have to get this project going by September 2012, and they said it was in the contract. Now, all of a sudden, that date has magically disappeared, and the date that actually shows up is, oh, we just need to get it done by 2017. I think they're hoping that nobody goes back in time and says, how many times did they say fall of 2012 construction must begin? We'll go back and count. We'll get back to you. They also said today that they think that the price is going to decrease. I have to say, I think the price is going to increase. I say that because I come from the ground up, seeing the plans and the project being built. They don't have it's not cohesive. So what happens when you start doing something that's not cohesive? Your costs start increasing. So even though the governor and the authorities may say the price is going down, we know at the backside the plans aren't finished and the price is going up. So we're probably going to be in that 100-some-odd billion, which is on page 230 of the business plan, which is hidden and only mentioned once. The 98.5 is not the realistic number. 117.6 is the realistic number. I did also notice today that they had indicated that, well, the ARRA mandates that this begin in the Central Valley. And I had somebody came up here, and I know they're jokingly saying it's the train to nowhere. That's our nowhere. We work hard on it. And it works hard for all of you people. So it's not just our nowhere. And I took Mr. Hartnett's comments that said that they're going to be giving $1 billion to the southern and northern areas because he feels that it's best if they can direct where that money is. I challenge you, give that money to our $6 billion to us, and we'll put it to good use. We will get high-speed rail going. Disband the authority. The time is not now. The authority is not the team. Give it to somebody else that can get it done.
Thank you, Mr. Fukuda. And thank you for your comments. Next witness is?
My name is Ross Browning.
Welcome, Mr. Browning.
From Kings County. Before I go on, I would like to thank Dan and Jim for being here. This is the first time that I've ever been at a hearing that anyone from the board has stayed for the public comment. I don't know if it's going to do any good, but thank you for being here. My theme, I'd like to talk to you about two things. It caused me a deal of nervousness, some anxiety, and the reason is because I can't find an answer to these things. I have no answer to give to my grandkids, great-grandkids, and they are, it takes two different forms. I imagine that I wake up one morning and somehow this system, which I don't believe can be built for Prop 1A, somehow this system is built. I don't know how it happened, but it's there. And all of a sudden, and they realize then we don't have any more money. Well, the system is built, so everything is good, except there is no infrastructure. They keep saying we're going to do it like they do in Europe. Europe has the infrastructure first, then they built the rail system, the long-distance rail system. That's one of the things I have no answers for. The other one is, if we build it in the valley, or bookends, or wherever you want to build it, but somewhere it's going to be in the valley, it's going to start in Fresno, and let's say the money runs out. There is no more money. The California public is just fed up. We just aren't going to spend any more. What do we do then? We've got a big hole, and there's no money left. Thank you much.
Thank you very much for your comments. Jerry Brazell and Terry Halsamer.
Thank you, Senators. I'm Jerry Brazell. I live in the peninsula 700 feet from the right-of-way, and I'm in favor of high-speed rail. The topic is faster, cleaner, and cheaper. It's faster, cleaner, and cheaper. When I'm done, I'm going to give you a test on this. Okay? Faster, cleaner, cheaper. Okay, I use the rail system. When I was in the Army, over 50 years ago, I took leave to Japan and rode the Japanese bullet there. And I thought, gee, this is great. We'll have something like that in 10 or 15 years in the United States. Well, over 50 years later, we're still talking about it. I took a trip to China 6 years before the Olympics and rode the maglev train over there. And I thought, wow, you know, I've been in Europe and all of that, and I keep looking around. The whole world's ahead of us, really, and to me it's shameful. Now, I use the rail, and I've taken the trains down to Senator Lowenthal's area there in Los Angeles from San Jose. Now, Senator Correa, how long do you think it would take to go by train from San Jose to Los Angeles? I'm hard of hearing.
Now, just go right ahead. It's your microphone.
Sir. How long?
I'll take it as a statement, so continue.
Okay. Well, anybody in the audience know how long it takes?
11 hours.
No, it takes 11 hours.
There you go.
Okay. There you go. 11 hours. That's shameful and disgraceful. We need something faster, which is high-speed rail. How long do you think it takes by high-speed rail to go from San Jose to Los Angeles? 2 hours. That's progress. That's real progress. Faster, cleaner, cheaper. Well, I've hit the faster part. I'm right on the time for cleaner and cheaper, but that was the topic, and I could get into that. But
thank you.
I'm out of time.
Thank you very much. Is Terry Holzamer still here?
Gary Wesley from Mountain View. What's going to happen with the ridership when a train derails? There are some million people who have been employed since 9/11, 2001 in Homeland Security. When bin Laden was caught, the federal government contends that there were plans in that compound to attack American trains. Nobody is going to ride on this system the first time a terrorist derails it.